And I'm going to give this panel a bit of a cliched name, which is, this is a panel about minding the gap. Those of you familiar with that phrase know where it comes from. And as we reflected on this in getting ready for today, it occurred to me, that perhaps there's always been a gap between the world in which children live and the world in which they go to school. And it's probably the case that you could always characterize that gap as a gap between a world of scarcity and a world of abundance. Think about one of the first cases in the United States about education to reach the Supreme Court. It was a father suing the school for teaching his child things that he didn't know. Think about the world of abundance that was available in the school that was a threat to this world of scarcity that belonged to the father. Think also about the numerous autobiographies of people written about the role school played in their lives, or learning played. Frederick Douglass, once a slave, once learned to read, became a free person. Mary Anton was an immigrant to the United States who passes through public school and becomes a native. What's different about today's gap is that today it's the schools that occupy the world of scarcity and the kids who come into it from a world of abundance. It's the teachers who are the immigrants and the kids who are the natives. As we heard earlier in one of the presentations, schools still promote an old metaphysics, and it's one of scarcity of time, limited time, right? Limited time to answer a question, limited time to learn information, limited time to finish a test, limited time to stay in a subject. It's a place limited by space, right? School exists within a certain physical place. It's a place limited by content, their right answers, their right books, their closed book tests. It's a world of limited people, limited authority. The teacher has the answer. The teacher is the one in the classroom. It's also characterized by pedagogy of scarcity, right? Memorization, grades, sage on the stage. It's limited by policies of scarcity, where information is not available broadly, right? A fifth grade teacher, it'll take her till December to figure out what the fourth grade teacher knew at the end of the year, and no one's allowed to tell her. And I think it's also fair to say it's characterized by the attitudes of threat that come in a world of scarcity, right? If this information is published, that says something about me. If I share this with you, if I share my answer with you, then I lose something rather than we both gain something. And I don't have to go into all the opposites that characterize the world of abundance available outside the walls of school. But if the gap has always been between scarcity and abundance in education, and now we have the reverse, the question for us on this panel is, how do we mind this gap? Is this a gap that's closable? Is this a gap that's going to close on its own? Is this a gap that should be closed? Is the gap only widening, making less relevant this physical thing called school? And might it be, just like we learned before, that five is an infinite set of five things? Maybe we need to rethink about school as an infinite set of possibilities, an abundance of possibilities, rather than a scarcely defined thing as we know it today. These are some of the questions we're going to explore in this panel, and the idea, the reason for the first five rows, was to encourage more of an intimate setting. We are going to have presentations from a distinguished panel from various perspectives on this question. We will have a live Twitter feed, yes? Are we? I think so. If not, we're going to pause at various places to get your questions, but really to keep in mind the larger overarching question, which is, how are we minding this gap? Should we be minding this gap? And what's happening in the world to contend with this gap? So we have lots and lots of people with wonderful things to say, but we also want to hear from you, so you're going to help me to do this. And we're going to start kick this off with a presentation from Professor Renee Hobbs, who's going to introduce herself and tell us how she's minding this gap from the perspective of schools.
I thought what I would do is provoke with an example. I'm very interested in this gap myself. My name is Renee Hobbs. I'm the founding director of the Harrington School of Communication and Media at the University of Rhode Island. And my organization's principal identity around the topic of media and education is the Media Education Lab. And the slides that I'm sharing and the videos that I'm sharing are available online here where it says Shaping the Future 2. So if you want to use them, rework them, remake them, I sure hope you do that. So these gaps that we speak about. I want to talk a little bit about the gap that teachers face with 40 heterogeneous kids in the classroom who have different competencies and different skills and different language abilities and different levels of motivation, and how teachers manage that diverse group of learners, because that's the principal job of being a good teacher. Now, almost all of our students, many of our students, have access to these technologies, the computer in the pocket. And that changes a lot of things about how we think about the internet. So I start with this question: what is the internet for? And for the last 3 years, I've been working in a Philadelphia urban elementary school, working with children and teachers ages 5 to age 11. We've been talking a lot about what they come to school knowing about the internet and what we can do between the ages of kindergarten and grade 5 to help them be ready for being lifelong learners with the full panoply of literacy, critical thinking, and communication and problem-solving skills that they need to be effective and to thrive in this ever-changing society. It turns out that depending on your family background and your parents' level of education, maybe your family history, maybe your socioeconomic class identity, you may come to school at age 5 thinking that the internet is to help you learn dance moves, like how to dance like Lady Gaga. Because in fact, the internet is a great place to learn new dance moves. One of the best places to learn the Gangnam style stomp, the pony, is just watch a couple of YouTube videos and you'll learn that dance. It's not that hard. But depending on which 5-year-old we talk to, some 5-year-olds come to school realizing that the internet is a place they can do research. It's like a virtual library. And you can go learn things and read things and discover things. Those children come in at age 5 already primed to think about the internet as a place for learning. So what do I do as a kindergarten teacher when some of my children come in thinking the internet is a place to learn dance moves and the other kids come in thinking it's a place to do library research? Well, by the time I see them, maybe in middle school or high school, I like to pay attention to the good students, right? So when we use the internet, we use it to do library research. We go to websites like this one about the French Revolution, and we read about the French Revolution. And many of my 7th, 8th, and 9th graders learn to cut and paste their way through history. They get better and better when they get to university at versions of this, cut and paste their way through learning. They jump through the hoops, they demonstrate whatever, but man, I'm not confident as a teacher that they really learned anything at all. But let's just say that same 6th, 7th, or 8th grader goes to YouTube and types in French Revolution. They might encounter this, made by the history teachers of Hawaii. Let's take a listen.
Inequality, the relics of feudalism, Revolution of France. All the previous days and should know this feudalism, Revolution of France. La, la, liberté, égalité, fraternité, a revolution. La, la, liberté, égalité, fraternité. red, 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 off with her hair. It went from 8 to 12 in a year. Exactly what impoverished peasants had feared. The royals cheered. Ha, 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 there's more for us. There was a famine, the peasants wouldn't pay. Bad malnutrition, tooth decay.
Right, so you might learn about the French Revolution that way, right? And if you did, well, at least you'd be able to start somewhere, wouldn't you? And let's just say you're 7th, 8th, or 9th grader, and you start with Bad Romance, made by a creative teacher using easy-to-use digital technologies. Let's just say that we wanted to imagine how the child herself or himself could move through a process of learning equipped with the right skills. I'd suggest to you that those skills can be called digital and media literacy, and that they build bridges between the classroom and culture. Because this same student, in fact, needs a set of skills in order to engage in self-directed learning, and that's lifetime learning. They need, an argument I'm going to make is that they need 4 sets of complex skills. As we expand the concept of literacy and stop thinking of education as those bricks that David Weinberger told us about, and start thinking about the competencies and skills with literacy at the center of that skill set, including the skills of access, use, and share, create and collaborate, analyze and evaluate, and practice social responsibility. Those of you who remember me 2 years ago, I used to call this reflect and act. And so now I'm thinking about it in a new way as I learn and grow myself. So those access, use, and share competencies are fundamental to the practice of literacy. And of course they include things like using a keyboard and a mouse and understanding software and being able to use social media and understand your information use and troubleshoot and problem solve. But the most important access skills? Listening and reading comprehension. And as a literacy educator, I want to make sure I do everything I can to make all the children in my classroom good listeners and good readers. That's a fundamental access skill in an information age. I also want to promote those skills of creativity and collaboration, helping students to compose and brainstorm and generate ideas and figure out their audience and their purpose and their point of view. And that means I might have to expand my concept of authorship as I help students see themselves as authors in a full and complex way. Collaborative authorship and curation and remix as authorship. Of course, I want my students to be able to analyze and evaluate information, and that means I want them to evaluate the credibility and the quality of information and to reflect on their own biases and their own worldview. And of course, I want students to practice social responsibility, to be reflective thinkers and to be socially active in the world. And that means applying ethical judgment and social responsibility in a variety of different online communication settings. So what if I let that child learn about the French Revolution in her own way, with the only idea, the only guidance being activate all 4 of those literacy skills? Find out what you can about the French Revolution in your own way, but activate all 4 of these literacy skills. Well, that's called project-based inquiry learning, and I'm delighted to hear that in Israel you are beginning to robustly experiment with this powerful kind of pedagogy, because it is the future of education. So let's say you might want to start by typing in Lady Gaga, because really, you're not interested in the French Revolution, remember? You're interested in Lady Gaga. And so you find that in South Korea last year, Lady Gaga's live shows, were banned to children under age 18. It says here in this New York Times article that if you were under 18, you couldn't go to a Lady Gaga show because they, in South Korea, because in South Korea, they determined that you might be at risk of picking up some bad values. Yes, you might learn about the French Revolution, but you might get some bad values. And then if you went online to Twitter, for instance, you might find out that there's a robust debate about whether or not we should ban going to Lady Gaga concerts to teenagers under 18. When you read that article, you find out that there's some pressure from Christian religious groups in South Korea that are causing this ban to happen. And so that might make you curious, and you might want to find out more about Christian religious groups in South Korea and why they don't like Lady Gaga and what they don't actually like. And when you get to this site, you're going to be forced to critically evaluate whose point of view is depicted, what's omitted and left out, and how does this represent information that has a clear, shall we say, ethical or religious set of values attached to it. Now you've got to think for yourself. Do you agree with this argument or disagree with this argument? You have to evaluate it. That might take you to the BBC News, where you try to figure out how the heck did South Korea get to be Christian to begin with? I mean, Asia? You know, Jesus didn't get all the way to Korea, right? So how did South Korea become Christian? And guess what you learn? It was right after the French Revolution, those French missionaries escaping the craziness going on in France, headed over to Korea and started their missionary work. So Lady Gaga and the French Revolution are kind of connected. And once you discover that those French revolutionaries were a big source of inspiration to Korean Christianity, then you might want to synthesize it and put it all together and think about, strong women who express themselves through creative work, about issues having to do with equality and justice. That might make you wonder about who was the Lady Gaga of her time during the French Revolution. And so if you type in French Revolution feminists, you find that you're going to meet Olympia de Gouges, a fantastic French feminist of her time who wrote a declaration on the rights of women in 1700s, and that might inspire you to make your own 2-minute video as this ninth grade California student did. Let's take a look. She started with Lady Gaga, she ended up with Olympia de Gouges, who was guillotined, by the way, and you're going to see that in acting here, so watch out.
Equalidad, fraternidad, oui. The people of France speak libertad. Libertad has many meanings, one being the liberty to stand alone to make your own decisions freely. Decisions that should be freely made without a man telling you what you can or can't do. A liberty allowing you to speak freely and not be worried of persecution. A society that I am tired of. A society that does not let me defend France. A society that does not even grant me the ability to take up a job to let me pay for bread to feed my children.
This student had an experience translating what she learned about the French Revolution into a short video. In doing so, she didn't just cut and paste her way through French history. She internalized some of the key ideas of what the French Revolution was aiming for, and she made connections between that past and her present. Digital and media literacy closes the gap between the classroom and the culture because it capitalizes on the idea of making information relevant. Relevance ignites intellectual curiosity, and intellectual curiosity fuels lifelong learning. Thanks very much.
So Renee, I want to ask you a question. As I listen to you, strikes me that, you know, in order for this child to go from Lady Gaga to the French Revolution, there was a lot of scaffolding that needed to happen, right? She didn't kind of happen on Lady. I mean, you started by saying she went to Lady Gaga because she wasn't interested, and then you tracked this series of things. And it strikes me that, contrary to what we may think, that in the digital age, teachers have a less of a role. What it sounds like you're describing is they have a much bigger role, meaning, you know, a traditional teacher would have to know the teacher's guide, right? To, I mean, I'm stereotyping, but they don't necessarily need to have thought of all the possible things out there in the universe that might eventually connect to the French Revolution. They would need to know certain key dates and key facts and key documents, perhaps key stories. So perhaps you could share with us a little bit your sense of what kind of teaching or teacher needs to be minding this gap.
Thank you so much. That's a great question. I mean, it's the teacher as co-learner is the model that we advocate. You should be learning alongside with your students, and that's what it means to be a lifelong learner. Right? And actually, we found that the teachers who are most successful with digital and media literacy are the ones who give up their mastery, give up their authority, and actually are more excited about the unknown than the known.
Are there any teachers in here today? So how does that sound to you? Is that the role of the teacher now?
I think that the teacher needs to want to be learned, if you may say so. Mm-hmm. They need to learn this kind of technology and master it. When they master it, they can play with that, because it's kind of playing. If you're playing with that, so you can teach it without fear. And if there is any chance that the kids will know better than me, so as a teacher, I'm afraid that I won't be able to teach them what I want to teach. The teaching part is different now, because we are not teaching them what, we are teaching them how to learn, how to use the tools that they have in order to skill all kinds of things. So we teachers need to learn how to teach differently today.
So the gap you're exposing is a gap between a vision of teaching as coverage to a vision of teaching that's about discovery or uncovering, and that's not necessarily an easy one to cross. I think our next speaker is going to talk about adaptive learning and perhaps touch on some of these issues as well. And Eric, I'm going to ask you to introduce yourself, and you can.
So my name is Eric Frank. My background is a number of years at Thomson, and then which became Cengage, and then Pearson in product development, content acquisitions roles, headed up global marketing for a division of Pearson for a number of years, and then in 2007 started Flat World Knowledge, which was an openly licensed digital college textbook publishing company. That company is doing well today, and recently left to start a new venture in partnership with Carnegie Mellon University. And Carnegie Mellon University, for those of you who know it, brings sort of a triangle of deep expertise in cognitive science, the theory of how people learn, human-computer interaction, how people use computers to do things in their lives, and software engineering. And so they started a research project a decade ago. And the question they asked themselves was, can we take what we know about the science of learning, how people learn, apply it to online learning environments, and produce measurable improvements in learning? Measurable being a very important word there. And 10 years later, the research is back, 20 plus peer-reviewed papers, and the answer is yes, at least in some disciplines. And by that, I mean that students are doing better on things like pretests, post-tests, midterms, final exams, retention 12 months later of the information, the content that they learned, and most importantly, in an online environment tested against the traditional classroom, learning the content in 50 to 70% of the time on task that it's taking the students in the traditional classroom. So I don't advocate what I'm about to talk about as the solution to education. I think it's far from that. But I think about as we think about the world of textbooks, and we think about what they become in the future, the work that a student is doing outside of the classroom sometimes needs to be about learning some foundational material. So that, I think, in some ways this dovetails quite nicely, they can come to class and the teacher has more information about what the student knows and what they don't know, and is able to engage in problem-based learning and inquiry-based learning when they're in the classroom, given a better foundation of what's happening outside the classroom. So I want to just talk a little bit about this idea of web analytics to improve learning. So this is a little bit not quite the point of the session, I think, in some ways. This idea, I think, was what are students experiencing outside the classroom consciously in the culture and life of students that's not happening in the classroom. This is a little different in the sense that as web consumers of almost any age, we leave data trails everywhere we go. So this is about this idea of data on the web. And those data trails are valuable in many different ways to many different players. Those data trails, where we've been and what we've done, can reveal a lot about our sentiments, our attitudes, our social connections, and they can predict to some degree what it is that we might do next. And you can see applications of this all over the place. The CIA, all intelligence operations around the world, looking for monitoring of online activity to try to predict who might do something that they would prefer that they don't do, so that they can launch, operate in advance of things happening. This is a $3 million prize in healthcare, where the idea was, can you build algorithms to basically identify who is likely to end up in a hospital next year. And if you can figure out us, help us identify who will be in a hospital next year, maybe we can do something to prevent that. And for insurance companies, you can imagine that this would be a very valuable asset to have. Similar activity with Deloitte, trying to predict lifespans for life insurance companies based on data of what people are doing around the web and algorithms to try to determine how long they might live. Certainly in the world of every website we visit, there's probably some tool underneath it gathering data about what pages we're visiting, how long we're spending there, what we're doing there, and somebody is analyzing that data trying to figure out how to keep you there a little bit longer, generally of benefit to the advertiser who's trying to advertise something to you. So there are basically recommenders and matchers everywhere based on algorithms using the data that we are leaving behind in data trails online. What about education? So this is a bad picture of me, but this is how I feel when people talk about what I just talked about and then say that, oh, well, all this goes on. I think that I can be the Amazon of education. I can take all this big data and I can run algorithms on it and I can figure out what works. And we can recommend to students things that work versus things that don't work, and we're going to solve all the ills in education. I fundamentally don't believe it. I don't believe the sort of big data approach to educational learning analytics is going to work. Our outcomes are not the same as Netflix. They're not the same as Amazon. They're very different. So what are the outcomes of many of the entities online? Well, if you have a data mining algorithm, it wants to optimize for something. So let's call something profit. And if you're Amazon or Netflix, what you're basically trying to do is say, I did X to my product. In the case of, say, recommending a movie to you, I made a movie recommendation to you on Netflix. Did they give me more dollars? And I can keep testing this idea. And if you get it right 1 in 100 times, that was worth it to you to run that analysis and make the suggestion because you got one more purchase and you did no harm, arguably. We don't have it that easy in education. If we want to do learning analytics right, it's a lot more work, but I think that the payoff is potentially tremendous. So our outcomes, learning, are very complex, as you just saw. In the example of trying to learn about the French Revolution, you're also trying to learn how to be a learner. So we have complex outcomes, and the inputs aren't that obvious either, right? We have a whole rich set of inputs into what educating somebody means. But I think in an online environment, we have an opportunity for the first time ever when the student's interacting with content and material online to measure learning the entire time in which they are online and track how those activities should further shape the educational experience that they're having. So I'll define this idea broadly of education analytics as the measurement, collection, analysis, and reporting about learners and their contexts for purposes of understanding and optimizing learning and the environments in which learning occur. So this is a broad definition of education analytics, but not all education analytics are the same. So I think about them this way, borrowed from Mike Sharkey at the University of Phoenix, actually, that there are learning analytics. What is somebody actually learning? And can we measure what they're actually learning? There are engagement analytics, which we think of as, and these are the two primary, I think, types of analytics that people talk about today. I think about engagement analytics as clickstream data. This is sort of what I was talking about to a large degree with Netflix, Amazon, et cetera. This is analyzing the clickstream of a student. It's what a learning management system might be gathering. What time did they log in? How many times did they log in? How long did they stay? How many objects did they interact with? How many pages did they view? What did they do? I think of all that as useful, but it's a proxy for learning. It's about engagement. Is the student engaged or not? As opposed to learning data, which are course level outcomes and skills and competencies, the things a student is supposed to be able to do when they're finished with a course. So I think that clickstream data tells us if a student is using material, but not what they're doing with it, why that interaction, what it's supposed to achieve, and whether it was achieved or not. Whereas I think about learning level analytics, as about gathering up the kinds of things you might ask yourself if you're a teacher and you're trying to analyze a student's performance. How often is the student getting it right on the first try? Do they eventually get it right? How often are they asking for help? Is this a difficult skill? Is it not a difficult skill? You have to take into account all of these things if you're going to generate meaningful analytics. So I think that answering these and many other questions require semantic data. You can't really get semantic data that generates meaningful learning analytics unless you have understand the inputs into the system. So this is really, in some ways, about design of online education, design of online content, design of online experiences in an intentional way to be able to generate out of them semantic data that provides meaningful insight into what a student has learned and has not learned. So I'll give you one example of this, and I'll show you something, and then that will bring us to a close. So with clickstream data, we can learn, basically, student X clicked Y at time Z. Fundamentally, that's sort of what clickstream data can tell us. Whereas with semantic data, as the student's working through, say, an activity or a problem or a multi-step problem online, we can say student X has asked for his second hint on part three of the question, what are the five steps of this program? And the system told that student back, recall that you need to identify a base case for your function. The correct answer will be line 5. The question is related to the specific skill in the model called the recursive base case, and it's often mistakenly answered as line 4 due to a common misconception. That's a lot of information about the content that we know. That student proceeds with clickstream data, and we learn again that student X clicked Y at time Z. Whereas with semantic data, we can capture and store that student X has now moved on, and they've selected line 5, which is correct. They were given this feedback, you're correct, line 5 is the base case. This was her third try, though it's the first question about this particular skill, and it's the third related question in the material. So we have a lot of information if we design online content and online environments intentionally. So what can we do when we know this? We can generate very meaningful, I think, feedback loops based on student learning data. Feedback loops to the student themselves, to instructors or teachers who are teaching those students, to somebody if they're responsible for course design, maybe that's CET, who built a course and the teacher's using that course and a student's learning from that course. And I think that the basic principles here are familiar with most people who've designed course content, right? Which is this triangle of very clear and measurable learning objectives tied to instructional activities for each of those learning objectives with formative primarily, but some summative assessments that provide feedback on the student's status, their, on those knowledge and skills. Underlying, I think, something like this, meaningful analytics, is a very thorough and concrete skill map, which says these are literally all the objectives, all the skills mapped to each of those objectives, and hopefully across something like Bloom's taxonomy, so that we're not just asking base level stuff like, do you remember this, did you understand it, but can you apply this? And you can have all of those levels incorporated into a skill map. And so I'm going to give you an example from the Open Learning Initiative at Carnegie Mellon University of just a few elements of what that learning experience looks like. So there might be a subject in statistics. There might be a little bit of content. There might be a multimedia walkthrough after the text that walks the student through how to do something. And then immediately there's learn by doing. There is this idea of supported practice, where the student now has to input something. This case is an Oscar winner's data about a data set from the Oscars, which is an award for TV and movies in the United States. And the student now has to input variables in this particular question. They input, if they get the wrong answer, they get specific feedback about why that answer is wrong. They follow that up with, okay, did I get this? Now I'm going to do a self-check problem where they actually are able to go through. They're able to work through this problem. Again, they're getting feedback on right and wrong answers. In this case, in this particular problem, they're trying to determine forces, vector forces in a statics problem. So this is higher education content. But again, they're working through a problem. They're entering responses. They're getting hints. If they want to, like a tutor, they don't understand it yet, they want to expand the problem, they can expand the problem and work through an additional set of steps, get additional hints for that particular step. And eventually there's opportunities to synthesize. So they can actually, this is a chemistry lab, but the idea is every few modules of online content, they have to synthesize what they've learned. Here they're trying to figure out level of arsenic contamination in well water in Bangladesh and trying to figure out if this well water is above or below World Health Organization standard. But ultimately, out of all that, we're able to capture very important data about the student's learning state. So this is an example of a dashboard that an instructor might get as the student's working through that content. So here there, on the left, you see the learning objectives, or at the top, I should say. If the bars to the left are gray, it means a student hasn't done enough practice for us to make a meaningful evaluation of whether they know this learning objective or not. If it's on the other end and it's green, then we can assume they know it. And if it's in the middle, they're at varying states of trouble. They don't know it well enough yet. And if you click on this bottom one is expanded. And what that now shows is a by student learning estimate. So I can now click on any particular area and see the number of students and exactly who they are that are struggling with their particular concept. I can communicate with those individual students. And I can also drill, I can also drill down by, if you look back here in this sub-objective, there's also, or this objective, there are also sub-objectives. So there are specific little skills that make up that learning objective, and I can drill down by sub-objective to see what an individual student knows. So now I'm on a fake student here, and I'm on that particular learning objective and all the sub-objectives. I can see the problems that students worked, and so I can keep drilling down for meaningful data. A student themselves can benefit from this data being incorporated into course material that they're working through. This happens to be a student view as they begin a new module of content. It's telling them what they know and what they don't know. It's generating an individual learning plan based on the student's specific knowledge. And the student can click down here in that learning plan to get additional practice. So again, it's sort of saying, this is, we understand that you know these things, you don't know these things. We're not telling you what to do, we're not directing you through the material, but we're giving you an option based on what you don't know to do more work. And I'll give you just one more quick example. These are very low fidelity mock-ups, but the idea being that for someone who designed a course, you could actually know before a course was released whether it was complete. Do I have all the learning objectives? If I have a learning objective, do I have activities and assessments tied to it? And so you can see whether a course is actually ready for release. You can imagine looking at a course afterwards as a course designer and identifying objectives where there's low performance relative to a standard and say, I want to drill down and find all the objectives where students went through and there were low performance. And then I can drill in on any one of those. I can see where the low performance is. I can drill down to the content, and I can assess why the students might be underperforming on that objective. So I just wanted to give that as an example of, I think, what's possible if we start thinking about something different than the textbook paradigm for this kind of content, which is content that needs to be absorbed and understood, and then more creative things can happen in class. If we move away from a traditional textbook paradigm and into an online environment where students are interacting with content designed to generate meaningful learning analytics. I'll conclude by a warning, which is that Michael Feldstein, is an education blogger in the US, wrote, since doing good learning analytics is hard, we often do easy learning analytics and pretend they are good instead. And I think that this is a risk as we move into the world of learning analytics. We have all had this experience. You know, just because I watched the Britney Spears video does not mean that, or because I did look up something on IBM that I should be watching a Britney Spears video, right? Sometimes recommendations don't go well. It doesn't hurt us in this environment. There are some pretty bad analytics out there. So for example, this is No, it's a textbook reader. And so here it's measuring, you know, how many pages did I read? How long was I logged into my ebook? How many annotations did I make? And it's telling me my overall progress is excellent and it's giving me an engagement score. What does any of that actually mean? Maybe I'm not a note taker. Maybe I left the computer on and I walked out for half a day and came back. And so I think there's danger to do a lot of bad analytics. But I think we have an opportunity to actually measure what learning is taking place, to use that data to inform course design and improvement, to inform instruction, and to enable students to inform their own pathway through content more effectively. And that's an opportunity that is available to us. So, thanks.
Thank you very much. I want to ask a question and then throw it open. So it sounds to me, from what you've said here, that this is in effect offering tools to better do the work of the traditional classroom. In other words, you're offering ways of tracking whether students have in fact mastered the core elements of a set curriculum.
Yeah, I think we started this day by Ellie laying out a question, which is how do we help teachers who have 45 students or whatever it is in front of them who have different levels of preparation, different backgrounds, different levels of mastery, not only when they begin, but all the way through that course. And we have no way of really doing that today. We don't know when they go off and read the textbook whether they learned anything. We find out when they do summative exams what they know and they don't know, but it's at a superficial level and it's too late. It's past the moment when we might have been able to fix that and they were able to build on that knowledge to do the next thing. So I think that this is in some ways a way of saying there is a future in which as the student is working through material away from the class, we might be able to actually know where they all are at in a very measurable way. And there's lots we could do with this. We could change what we do in class the next day as an instructor to address deficiencies. We could match students who know the material really well with students who don't know it well and have the students who are knowing it well tutor the students the next day in class. We could simply free up time as students work through the material more effectively to do more problem-based learning in the class. So I think it's a future that says if we're going to assign them materials away from class that are in a traditional mode, that there is a lot more that we can get from that.
So do you see this as entrenching the existing framework or leading, say, on the Khan Academy model to something that ends up in a flipped classroom, that ends up saying the analytics allow us to track what they've, you know, the factual stuff, and then turn the classroom into a place that looks more like what you brought us, which is something that's more innovative and going beyond the fact base?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's taking it to its logical place and making full advantage of it is to say that I can now flip the classroom based on having information I didn't have before, having students doing things that they didn't do before outside of class, so I can do something different that's evidence-informed inside of class. So I think that is the right place to sort of eventually take it.
I think you have a question here in the front row.
כשאתה הצגת את היכולת הזאת לעמוד על המקום בו נמצא כל תלמיד, אני חשבתי על סוג אחד של תלמידים, על התלמידים המתקשים. ואני חושב שאחד האתגרים שלנו בתור אנשי חינוך זה באמת ההתייחסות לתלמידים המתקשים ולהזדהות עם הקשיים שעומדים בפניהם. אחד היתרונות הגדולים של המערכת הזאת, שאולי אתם לא מודעים לה, זה היכולת שלנו לתת מענה לתלמיד שמתקשה. אלה מכם שהם אנשי חינוך, יודעים שהתלמיד שקשה לו יצביע פעם אחת, אולי פעמיים, אבל לא יותר מזה. היכולת של המורה באמצעות מערכות שמבקרות את הלמידה בריל טיים, לזהות את התלמידים המתקשים ולגשת אליהם בדיוק כמו שניגשים לתלמידים המצטיינים, בלי לעורר תשומת לב ובלי להדגיש אותו אל מול פני הכיתה ובמידה מסוימת להשפיל אותו בזה, יש בזה משהו שיכול להיות אלמנט מקדם אמיתי בלמידה. לי כמנהל בית ספר הרבה פחות חשוב המעקב המדוקדק אחרי כל התלמידים. הרבה יותר חשוב לי זה שהתלמידים ירגישו טוב בלמידה. במערכת הזאת שאתה הצגת בלי להתייחס לעניין הזאת, לעניין הזה, יש מענה מצוין ליכולת שלנו לסייע ולהגיע עד אחרון התלמידים.
Yeah, I think, thank you for that. I mean, I think that, this has been primarily used in settings in higher education. But I think interestingly, the place where it's had the greatest impact are in places where, and I can only measure this by student financial aid, but where there are highest levels of students receiving financial aid, which means that you have students who are coming in probably from some of the areas, high schools which are under-resourced, which have highest student-to-teacher ratios. They're coming in from poor families, many times they're first generation college goers. And it is actually the data coming back to both teachers and to tutors assigned in that class is actually being used in a way that can identify struggle without that student having to raise their hand, without having to embarrass that student. And somebody, the teacher or the tutor, is able to intervene in a very specific and meaningful way. And I think that's a astute observation.
שמי ענבר, אני ממתח, ממחלקת הטכנולוגיה. ובין היתר, אנחנו מנהלים גם מערכת LMS שעוקבת אחרי מצב התלמיד, הוא מבצע משימות, גם בתוך קורס וגם כמשימות בדידות. וממש מאוד דומה למערכת שהוצגה כאן. אני במסגרת העבודה שלי עם השטח והעבודה עם הטכנולוגיה מהצד השני, נתקלת הרבה פעמים בסוג של קונפליקט, בעצם מה המקום של כיתה, חדר עם כיתה ומורה ותלמידים, כשיש לנו בעצם מערכת שכל מה שצריך לעשות זה להתחבר, לבצע את העבודה, המורה יכול להעריך אותה מהבית או מכל מקום אחר, והשילוב הזה שבין הטכנולוגיה לבין ההימצאות בתוך חדר אחד עם תלמידים אחרים, בעצם מיותר באיזשהו מקום. והייתי שמחה לשמוע את דעתכם.
So I think that, you know, obviously this question comes up frequently. Is this the end of the role of the teacher? What is the role of the teacher? And I think that in some ways, I only think about something like this as a more effective set of learning materials. Learning materials they've been about setting foundation, and I think of them as training, but education, I think, is different than training. And I think that if we separate those things and say that systems like this, in which the student has a richer experience and it generates more meaningful data, as opposed to working their way through a static textbook, for example, or something where they're not generating that data, is simply a better training experience, and it's providing data that allows for better education. I think that then an instructor can intervene with an individual student and help that student overcome what they're stuck on. And that's where real education happens. When there's a learning moment, a student is stuck, they can't do something. Specifically, what it is they're stuck on is now evident. Based on the data coming from the system, and the educator can intervene and help educate. Or they can, I think, do things like we heard earlier, which is to say, I can now do things in the classroom which are more meaningful and which are problem-based because I have more information about what people know. If they already know all that, that's fantastic. Let's take it further. And so I think that to some degree the role of the educator will change based on having more and more data, but it won't go away.
Well, I think the next presentation is going to also go to the place of children. It's often said that in kindergarten you learn by play, or up through kindergarten you learn through playing, and then it goes away and you gotta go to this formal structure called school, and there are people trying to rethink the role of gaming as part of education, continuing on the paradigm of the kindergarten, and Brian is one of them, and we're delighted to have you with us to bring that perspective to this question of minding the gap.
My name is Brian Wineski, and I'm the managing director of an organization called Institute of Play. I'm going to start just by saying a few words about the Institute and then dive deeper into one of our projects. The challenges we're facing today as a species seem to be more numerous and more complicated and more intractable than ever. We're here today to talk about one of them, but the fact is that there are many of them, and they're all interrelated. And probably to address them well, we're going to have to learn new ways of being and doing, new ways of being and doing as individuals, in teams or groups, and in large-scale collectives that cross borders. And probably to do that, we'll have to leverage the really powerful communications technologies at our disposal now. And that's really what the work of the Institute is all about. It's about trying to explore those new ways of learning, those new ways of engaging, rooted in play, that will enable us to survive and thrive as a species into the 21st century. So right now, the work of the Institute is, the top is kind of cut off. It just says Institute of Play. The work of the Institute is split into three areas of focus. The first area of focus is the work that we do in schools, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today, so I'll just gloss over it. The second area of work is something called Glass Lab. And Glass Lab is a project we just started a year ago, and it's an attempt to rethink assessment. So right now, we're pretty good at assessing what knowledge or facts are in a student's head at any one moment in time. And we're okay at assessing what they can do if the task is very constrained. This is an attempt to look at a new way of assessing and using games as the medium of assessment. So can we drop a player into a game world, a very complex simulation, and from the choices they make within that world, the real-time choices they make, build inferences that add up to valid, reliable assessments? That's the question of Glass Lab. And we're going after that question using commercial-grade video game IP. So we have a big company like Electronic Arts in Silicon Valley giving us the IP to experiment with. We have the educational testing service, ETS, providing the assessment expertise. We have a company like Pearson working on questions of big data. How do we put these very sophisticated data backends in the service of student learning? And we have Institute of Play providing the learning design expertise. The goal of that project at the end of 3 years, it's been funded for 3 years, is to reach 1 million students with these new assessment tools. The third area of work is something called ABLE, and ABLE is all about building learning communities that exist across institutions, across disciplines, across geographies, and finding ways to support those so that they're vibrant and sustained. So those are the three areas of work that the Institute is engaged in. We've produced all sorts of high-tech stuff, like really complex simulations, immersive learning environments, online challenge-based platforms, apps, online games, but I'm not going to talk about any of that kind of stuff. I'm going to talk about the low-tech stuff that sits behind the high-tech stuff, and without which the high-tech stuff has no meaning, the learning design. So at the heart of the work of the Institute is a school that we created called Quest to Learn. Here are the basic stats of the school, and then I'll dive deeper into the inner guts of the school. So the school exists in New York City. It is a public school. Say it again, it's a public school. So anyone who wants to go there can. It's in District 2, if you know Manhattan, which is one of these strange districts that encompasses some of the richest neighborhoods in Manhattan and some of the poorest. What else? We're serving about 400 kids. It opened in 2009. It's now a 6th through a 9th grade. By 2015, it'll be a 6th through a 12th grade. The racial ethnic mix is what you'd find in most District 2 New York City schools. The socioeconomic marker that's used in the U.S. is something called free and reduced lunch. That's at about 40% of our student body, which is about double of what you typically find in District 2. because most of the schools in District 2 are selective, ours is not. There's also about double the population you typically find in District 2 of students who need what are called individualized learning plans. That's about 25%. We opened a second school in Chicago last year. It's called Chicago Quest. It's slightly different. It's a public charter. It's in the old Caprini Green neighborhood, if you know Chicago. Okay, so those are the statistics. So what makes Quest to Learn unique? What makes it unique is that it starts from a position that's very much in line with what Renee talked about, that the first and foremost, the most important thing in the school is to engage the students. We know that students who are engaged learn in a way that's very different from students who are unengaged. And we know that students who are engaged have a much greater chance of going on to succeed in their lives in ways that matter to them. So that might seem like a really obvious statement, but if you look at schools in the US at least, I don't know Israel, we might say we believe in engagement, but in fact, the reality shows a very different very different value system. And the students are voting with their minds, often, they're checking out, and some of them are voting with their feet. A third of them in the US don't finish high school, so they're dropping out. So at Quest Schools, none of the things that students naturally gravitate towards nowadays, whether that is Lady Gaga or hip hop or Facebook or mobile technology or mobile phones or games, none of that stuff is viewed as an obstacle to learning. It's viewed as an opportunity to build some really powerful, really powerful learning. And in fact, the whole school is sort of built around the metaphor of games. Why games? Well, it turns out if you look at what we know makes good learning and what we know make good games, there's almost a one-to-one correspondence between those two things. So, for instance, if you think about a game, games are nothing more than really rich problem spaces, right? They drop players into a problem space with a really clear goal, and then they set out multiple pathways to reach that goal. Levels. Oh, thank you. And we know that when students finish those levels, they've actually learned what they needed to learn to finish the level. So that's great. They're leveled to provide just the right amount of challenge that will keep a student moving through the system, not bored, not discouraged. That's great. They use data to deliver feedback that's actually useful to the student. Right? It's not a test score they get 4 months later. It's actually useful to them to navigate through this problem space. And in a multiplayer environment, it actually sets up a context for players to work with one another and to act as resources for one another, so to teach one another, which we know is some of the most powerful learning. Pacing is flexible, and there are multiple paths to mastery. Maybe the most important thing about games, though, is that they unlock something that's very powerful in people who play them. In the state of being known as play, people take risks that they don't take in normal life. They're okay with failure. In a game, everything is kind of practice. Wouldn't it be great if learning was like that too? So Quest to Learn is not a place where kids play games all day. It's certainly not a place where kids are like wired to the walls playing video games all day. But it is a place that's tried to understand what make games really great in terms of engagement, and to translate that into the redesign of the school experience. Okay, so now I'm gonna go a little bit deeper. So at the heart of Quest to Learn lies a very unique collaboration, and this is how the school really started. There are three people who really make the school magic. They are a game designer, a teacher, and a learning designer. They all bring really different kinds of expertise to the design process. The game designer knows a lot about engagement, and the teacher knows a lot about what actually works in a classroom. The learning designer, who was not in the original mix that we had in our head in terms of collaboration, acts as a bridge between the two and brings a lot of knowledge regarding what kinds of standards actually need to be hit, what actually needs to be taught in a particular grade level. So this team is actually responsible for developing everything in the school. They develop the curriculum, they develop learning objects, they co-develop activities, they develop all the professional development, they develop the schedules, the leadership structures, everything within the school. They also have another responsibility within the school that makes it slightly unique. They're responsible for the professional development of the teacher. So they provide the teacher a space where they can actually think and be reflective about their practice, where they can actually start to view themselves not as someone who everyone else is always telling the solution to and what they need to be doing, but who can design their own, design what happens in their own classroom. So we have a really strong value on the teacher in the school and a really strong value on the teacher as a designer in the school. And it's been really great to see over the last 4 years the teachers we've been working with to really step into that role and start to see themselves as designers. Okay, there's another function that these three people play is that they bring into the school resources that wouldn't typically be in a school. So a game designer brings with him or her all sorts of connections that wouldn't typically be in a school. Professional connections to game design networks, connections to museums, all sorts of connections. We have game designers who are ex-photographers, ex-architects. So they bring a really interesting mix into the school. The other interesting thing about this mix that we didn't set out, that we didn't plan to have happen, was that, so they're actually designing in the school. And we initially thought, in this design process, if the kids knew that we were designing their learning, they wouldn't believe in it. And so we tried to keep it secret. We realized, it's a funny thing, because we were game designers, right? And so we actually thought if people, when they play games, they just believe in it, and they play, right? So anyway, we kept the kids out initially. We couldn't keep them out, they came in, which was fantastic, because now it meant the kids were actually collaborating in the design of the learning that was happening. And that's what's, it's so interesting about these kinds of conferences, because they're about education. And who in the room is under 25? One person, under 18? Under 18? Oh, great. You didn't raise your hand for under 25. slow translation. Under 18. Anyone under 16? Okay, so 18 seems to be the cutoff. So here we are talking about education, and there are no kids in the audience. So that's just interesting to note. It's a mistake we made when we were building the school. Okay, so what do these guys actually design? What does the learning actually look like? So all the learning at Quest to Learn is designed to give rise to what we call a need to know in students. Okay, this means that students really want to know what we think we want them to know, and they're motivated to do it themselves. So you can think of that means over the course of a trimester, what the students are learning is sort of a carefully scaffolded set of challenges, which look very similar to the levels in a game. And this is the way all the learning is designed at Quest to Learn. So for instance, if students are coming into a math science learning domain, they are, on the first day of class, confronted by a message by Dr. Smalls. And Dr. Smalls is a doctor who has shrunk himself to put himself inside the body of one of his patients. And in shrinking himself, he's lost all his medical memory, and he's lost. And so he reaches out to the students for help. So they have no idea how to help him. They have no idea really what he's going to ask for, but they're immediately engaged in that story. And that's what we call a mission. So that's something that's a big challenge, no idea how to solve, last 10 to 15 weeks. Within that big challenge, the mission, there are a bunch of smaller challenges or quests. And quests basically build up in the student what they need to know to solve the big challenge. And all of the typical content that a student would typically learn in any other public school is covered along the way. But it's covered as a sort of natural function of the play of this mission. Okay, so this is what we mean by game-like learning, right? It's not a game, but it kind of looks like a game. It kind of takes the best of what games do. But it sometimes happens that a student identifies within the missions pieces of content that kids always struggle with. And in that case, the game designers will actually build a discrete game. And they'll drop it in at the point that students really need support. So this is a game that was developed for the Dr. Small's mission. It's called Metric Mystery. So the game mechanic of the game is all about measuring in the metric system. So that's what the kids are learning through the game. What's one thing you notice about this image? The teacher sits with the children, yes. What else? Everybody's interested. Yep, that's great. There's no computer. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a paper game. So about 70% of what we produce in the school is actually paper. A variety of reasons for that. One is the designers are developing about 3 weeks out before this stuff hits the classroom. Doing digital that quickly is just hard. The other is this school operates on a New York City public school budget. So hard to do digital on that. The third is, you know, paper works just as well as digital often. Okay, so can anyone guess what this is an image of? Comes from the school. Recess, someone said recess, so playtime. Any other? There's some kind of science project is going on, yeah. So it is a science project of sorts. It is recess of sorts. It's also an assessment. This is what assessments sometimes look like at the school. All the assessments, as much as possible at the school, are performance-based and embedded. What you're seeing here is a picture of a very special time at the school called boss level. Again, metaphor taken from video games. When you think you've mastered a level, then you meet the boss, and you have to fight him and beat him and prove that you've actually mastered everything. Boss level is a time when normal learning stops, and the whole school comes together to solve one big collaborative problem together. It's a special time with the school for a number of reasons. It tends to happen before vacation, so that's a time when kids are typically checked out. Our kids are not checked out. Two, it's a time when we can actually invite parents in, and they can see what's going on at the school, and the skepticism they might have come in with goes away. And three, it's a time when the community can come in. So whenever possible, we try to break down the walls between what happens inside the school and what's happening outside of the school. So we'll actually invite, so first of all, we often pick themes which get the kids out of the school into a museum or some other space where they can do work. And we also invite those people from cultural institutions in to act as judges in these assessments. And I'll show you what the back end of the assessment actually looks like in a second. So because Quest to Learn is a public school in New York City, we have to care about all the things that we're told we have to care about. But we know that that kind of content knowledge is not a good predictor of whether students are successful outside of school. So we care about that stuff, but we also care about two other kinds of competency sets. One of those is all what we call design thinking. So this is whether a student can use an iterative design process, whether they can be a creative seeker and solver of complex problems, whether they can persist past failure, those sorts of things. The other set of competencies we care about are socio-emotional learning. So can they work together in teams? Can they develop the skill of empathy? Those sorts of things. So whenever we do anything at the school, it starts with an assessment against those three kinds of competencies. And this, again, super low tech, this is what the assessment looks like. This is all eventually done on a computer system, but this is where it starts. This is the design stage. So any activity is assessed on a novice to master scale, again, taken from a video game. And then you see along this column on the left, the kinds of skills and competencies that are actually being assessed. And then the teacher will go through with this design team and think about what, in each of these cases, constitutes evidence for a novice level in dynamic thinking, apprentice level in dynamic thinking, etc. And these are actually shared with the students beforehand. So a student who wants to become a master in X actually knows exactly the kind of evidence they have to produce to get them there. This is a modification of an assessment design system called evidence-centered design. This is another kind of assessment. Whenever possible, the assessments, so BOSS level is one kind of summative assessment we use. This is what a more formative assessment looks like that are used throughout the course of the 10 to 15 week mission. It's basically a project. Again, the assessments sit behind it. The project serves as evidence of these different kinds of things that we're looking for. In this case, the students were asked to build a model of a city whose parts were analogous to the parts of a cell. So this is from the Dr. Small's mission that I talked about before. Again, super low tech. So this, am I okay on time?
I'd say 5 minutes.
Okay, a couple minutes. So this is an assessment, and that's great. Another thing that this serves to achieve is that it gets students making things. And this is where the digital media stuff gets really interesting, because suddenly students can understand in a very explicit way that knowledge is something that has been socially created and is only what we say it is. Whereas before you got a book with a sort of very authoritative set of facts, what David talked about as facts, now you get Wikipedia articles that are always changing and are very obviously dynamic in nature. Socially constituted bits of knowledge. And students, by learning in school, can suddenly participate in that. You know, they can make videos that can reach a million people. They can edit Wikipedia articles. They can work with the same data sets that scientists are working with. They can connect with experts outside of the schools. So basically, they can become producers and participants. I'm going to skip through the rest because we're out of time. I'm just going to talk about this for 1 minute. So games are a great design metaphor for the school because of all the things I've talked about. Probably the most interesting thing for us about games, however, is that they are systems. And one of the most important things at the school is systems thinking. So we think that unless kids are able to think in systems, in complex systems, and to be able to understand how through their participation in those systems, they can change them, they will not succeed in the world today. So games are systems that occur in a language kids naturally understand, play. So we can get them playing, we can get them engaged in that experience, and then we can get them thinking analytically about the experience. What are the components of the system you've stepped into? How do they construe your experience? And then from there, it's a very small step to get them to think about modifying the system in order to modify their own experience. From there, and again, we're just talking about games, but from there it's a very small step to get them to think about, well, I want to have this experience, I can't get it through modification, so I'm going to build my own system. So now I'm going to design a game from scratch. And from there it's a super small step to get them thinking about other kinds of systems. And in fact, as kids move through the school from 6th to 12th grade, the problems they're facing become less and less fictional and more rooted in the communities in which they're existing. So whereas in the 6th grade, the kids might be dealing with a fictional miniature doctor in the body, by the 8th grade, they're dealing with water quality issues in their own neighborhood. So that's a bit about the school. I could show you a video, but I won't. I could talk more, but I won't. So it often comes up, are you going to open a million of these schools? The answer is no. Opening schools, can we hire you to work there? Sure. Opening schools is tough. It's hard work. We've opened two and we're tired. But that's a kind of flip answer. The real answer is we're not going to open any more, but we hope that you will. And we can help you if you want to open them. So we're in the process of sort of breaking our model down into components, making sets of tools, sets of trainings that anyone can use, a teacher in a classroom who wants to know how to use games more effectively, or an administrator or school leader who wants to actually open a school.
I'm a school principal in Rishon LeZion, and I have a school like that. But we are only at the beginning. This is the first year, and we took this year to learn the staff, to learn ourselves how to do and how to play, because playing is nice, but you have to learn about it in order to I pass it to the children with the way you would like to. And we need a lot of help. So my question is, where do you think that we have to start farther more than we did? And how can we reach you to get help?
If you want to join mailing lists, when we publish tools or have training opportunities, they always get pushed out that way. I actually don't tweet, but we do have a Twitter account. There are these means. I'm happy to have a conversation about that. Opening a school is hard. Full of mistakes. We made a lot of them. We continue to make them. The people I talk to who open schools, the first year is just hard. You're always behind the ball and you're always struggling. And especially if you're trying to do an innovative model. I was at one school recently in São Paulo that's based on the Escuela de Ponchi model in Portugal. And their first year was tough. It's a model where they all the students, teachers, everyone decides everything together. There's no hierarchy. And they're dealing with kids who really have never been in school and don't know how to sit still. And so they spent the first year just as a community creating norms that would allow them to do the work of schooling.
אתם מלמדים או יודעים להתמודד עם ילדים עם בעיות התנהגות, אוכלוסיות חריגות? לא בעיות אורגניות, יותר בעיות רגשיות שמגיעות לבעיות התנהגות.
Oh. Yeah, I mean we get the full range of students that you'd find in a city like New York, and so we deal with them all. The handful of students that we have had leave the school, and there have been a handful, tended to have been people who were further along on the Asperger autism spectrum than we had resources to deal with, and so they actually needed more support.
Hi, my name is Shelley.
Hi.
I'm a principal in a Hayovel school in Ranana. If you could describe a typical day in your institution.
Yeah, so the school day is, you know, 8-ish to 3-ish. The kids will come in. The first thing they have when they come in is something called home base. Another school is called home room, and that's in our school is a group of kids whom we try to keep together throughout an entire sort of middle school, high school experience. Often with this, as much as we can with the same teacher, which is intended to provide a kind of grounding for their entire school experience. There's some wellness curriculum that happens in the home base. From there, they'll move into any number of classes. The schedule will shift from day to day for them. The learning is organized into what we call learning domains. So they don't go to like math class or science class. We tried to create learning domains that mimicked how people in the real world would interact with their subject area. So a mathematician would never just do math. They do math and they talk about math. So we put English together with math and we called it code worlds, both systems of meaning making. A scientist similarly would very rarely do pure science. They'd probably do some math too. And so we put those two things together and called it the way things work. So those are the kinds of classes students move through the course of the day. They tend to be in 40, 50 minute chunks, or sometimes slightly longer chunks, like an hour and 20 minutes. We experimented with longer chunks, it didn't work.
I think we'll have time at the end for more questions for everyone, but we're gonna try and go back to you, Cecilia.
I think that no doubt there's not one answer for everything, not only if every teacher fits a school like that, is the same thing for students. We don't know if all students fit a school like that, but I'm going to show why. When I came across Quest to Learn, searching for things in education, for me was an amazing model. We are extremely happy Brian came to tell us about it. I think no doubt if you're talking about narrowing the gap, I think they did. They did not narrow the gap, they finished with the gap. That doesn't mean, again, is the answer for every child, but I think no doubt from everything I've seen around, Quest to Learn is there. I mean, Quest to Learn is not trying to get a game, make it really nice, it put into the educational system. They try to understand what's happening. They try to understand the language of the kids. They try to understand the way kids are learning and developed a whole model based on that. So I think for me, talking about our panel subject, no doubt, I think for us it's a model. Now I'm gonna, I work at Mindset, which is the newest innovation center of Matar. So I don't want to talk a lot. I think there's much more interesting people here, but they asked me to tell a little bit about the work we are doing in Mindset to try to narrow the gap in and out of the classroom. Our main, our challenge at Mindset is to keep kids amazed. This girl, I think, shows exactly what we are trying to get at, because we believe that we are losing, and we are not pessimistic about it, I think we are realistic, we are losing the newest generation to much more relevant learning environments. So in order to keep the educational world relevant to kids, we must understand what's happening to kids. We must understand where kids are actually learning today, where kids are actually finding the answers to their questions. Our hypothesis is that kids have, they in a way gave up to the traditional educational system that doesn't really talk the same language they do, and they found a parallel learning system, and that gaming is has an important role within this learning system. As I think Brian said, for us gaming today within the kids' world is not only an entertainment activity, actually is fulfilling an important learning gap within the kids' world, and gaming has become an effective parallel path of education. So we decided to find out a little bit more about this world. We decided to ask kids what something about their relation with gaming in order to understand what's happening in their learning world. But for us was very difficult to do so, because when we started reading about it, most of the studies that we came across were trying to ask kids, but they were always doing with an adult next to the kid. So what happens, we all, except Brian and the people that work with him, we all have a sort of fear about the relation of gaming and the kids' world. We are all adults are a bit worried that kids spend actually too much time gaming. So this negative connotation, we thought that when a kid is answering questions about gaming with an adult next to him, will significantly affect his responses. So we tried to put a call in some online platforms and try to get kids voluntarily to click and to answer to our questionnaire. So we did that. We put a call in Hebrew and another one in Arabic and hope for the best. We were really, really lucky. In after a week, we had 5,500 kids that clicked, and we had 1,019 kids that actually answered a two-page questionnaire. In the beginning, everyone thought you were nuts. No kid is going to answer so much. Not only they answered, but we were so lucky that they actually answered thinking about the answers. We had very, very, very little percentage of kids that actually wrote silly things, which is very normal in online surveys. Most of the kids, here is the age range. Actually, there were some older, very few we took out from the sample. Most kids were from 8 to 13 years of age. We had 765 Hebrew speakers and 254 Arabic speakers. Most of the sample were boys, even though with the Arabic sample we have almost a 50-50. It was great. I chose only three answers to bring here today. This for us was very interesting because most of the studies we've read talk that kids play maximum of 2 hours a day. And actually, surveys asking parents, that's exactly the same answer. And we all know kids. We know this is not true. So for us, it was amazing that actually in our study, kids told us the real story, that they, after they come from school, the question was actually asking, after you come from school, and they said that they play most of the time, what they do is that they are playing digital games. Only 3% of the Hebrew speakers said that they never played for the last 2 days, and 18% of the Arabic speakers. And there was a very interesting question, I don't know if you can see down there. We asked kids if your parents control the amount of time you play, and twice as many girls said yes compared to boys. That's something society should think about. Okay, are digital games good for you? 7% said yes, and we asked why. They said because we learn things. And the second answer was, it is fun. And then, for me this was, I mean, Ran and I, here he is, that we did a study, we spent hours reading the answers of 1,100 kids about this question, what do you learn when you play games? Most kids talked about content learning. They said, I learn history, I learn English, I learn math, I learn things about the space, specific skills, I learn how to build, I learn craft. I think it's amazing the answers about thinking. They say that it helps me problem solving, helps me to build a strategy. There was a lot of answers about emotion as well. I brought this because I think this is a very, very interesting result. There's something that Jane McGonigal called blissful productivity, which is, she says that when we are playing games, games allow us to learn how to win and lose. She said that gamers are willing to work hard if they are given the right challenge, a challenge that matters, that is relevant. And not only that, when they fight to get that, they feel good about it. We had so many kids that said that in different ways. We brought just two examples. An 11-year-old boy that said, sometimes you lose and sometimes you win, and you learn not to be angry, but to try again. A 12-year-old girl that said, by playing, I learned to be calm, to focus on the target, and not to give up. What do you like most about video games? That actually reproduces what game designers told us, that the most important thing when they design a game is the story or content. As you see, it's interesting, the kill, fight, or shoot answer as well. Almost only boys said they like this part, which is also interesting. That's also a misconception, I think, a misconception that we are already learning that it is not like that. Kids don't play by themselves, and you can see here. Actually, kids play with everything. They play by themselves, but they also play with their parents, they play with their brothers, they play with friends on the same computer at the same time, they play with friends that are on another computer, and they also play with people they don't know. For the very, very parents that are very scared, in our sample, only 18 children said that they play with other players they don't know, but only 3% only play with people they don't know. Who help? Also relatives and friends. Was interesting because as kids get older, they said they use less relatives and more web search engines. This was an amazing result as well. Kids say that they learn how to navigate in the web because of games. They learn how to search knowledge and content in the web because of games. And that's the last one. For me, personally, it was a very exciting result. I truly believe Minecraft is an accidental pedagogical breakthrough. Accidental because the guy that designed Minecraft had no intention of of doing any pedagogical breakthrough, but I have no doubt it is. It is it's the most popular game in Israel, according to this study. And you can see here that actually kids play very interesting games, very engaging games, games that require collaboration, that require teamwork. Minecraft, for example, kids don't have any immediate reward. On the contrary, they get together with their friends to build things. They build teamwork to protect themselves from the monsters that come out at night. There's a lot of creativity, a lot of teamwork, a lot of feeling together. So, if we can conclude anything, in order to make the educational world relevant to kids, what we have to do first is to understand kids' parallel learning environment. Thank you very much.
שמי שזף, ואני מהמרכז לחקר האינטרנט, ואני אנסה להראות תמונה שאין בה לא חתולים ולא ילדים, לא לידי גאגה ולא מדונה, אבל יש בה את הגאפ שדיברת עליו. Mind the gap. So this is one gap that we can try to bridge. Three more sentences in English in the form of an abstract of what I'm about to say, and then the rest in Hebrew. So the abstract of what I'm about to say is that technology is disruptive, that the two important things about the disruption that it brings about are sharing and play. A lot has been said about play by the previous speakers. A whole lot less has been said about sharing on this panel and today in general, so I'll probably talk more about sharing than about play, not because I have less to say, but because that's what I'm interested in. אז עיקרי הדברים, אם אני הולך לדבר על הטכנולוגיה, טכנולוגיה מערערת בעין, שהיא גם מהרהרת בהי, ושני המושגים העיקריים שלדעתי צריך לתת עליהם את הדעת, כמורים, כמנהלים, כמפתחי תוכניות, כמי שמקבלים החלטות, בהקשר של פיתוח מדיניות, שני הממדים שאני רוצה להאיץ בכולנו לחשוב עליהם כרלוונטיים, הם הממד של שיתוף והממד של משחק. על הממד של משחק נאמר פה הרבה ונאמרו דברים מאוד מעניינים, בין השאר על ידי בריאן ועל ידי ססיליה וגם על ידי אחרים. על נושא השיתוף נאמר פחות בשעות האחרונות, ואני חושב שזה חשוב. אז הפער שעליו מדברים, the gap that we're discussing, התהום הזאת שעליה אנחנו הולכים על גשר צר מאוד, זה גם תהום בין הכיתה ושאר החיים, זה גם תהום בין האנלוגי והדיגיטלי, זה גם תהום בין העבר והעתיד, ובכל המקרים האלה אפשר לקבל פחד גבהים. בתהום הזאת שורצים תנינים שגורמים לאנשים לפחד לאמץ את הטכנולוגיה, גורמים למערכות להתנגד, לתקוע עקבים ברצפה ולהתנגד, ועלינו לשאול את עצמנו מה קורה כשארגונים, מוסדות, מערכות, תוכניות לימוד וכן הלאה נגררים אל מציאות שהם לא יזמו ושהרבה פעמים הם לא תומכים בה. התמונה אחת שלא אראה פה, לפני שאני אגיע לתמונה הזאת, היא התמונה שמדברת על המודל שאנחנו כבר חווים פה כמעט שעתיים של מישהו חכם, present company excluded, עומד על במה ומדבר אל קהל. זה המודל של הכיתה הקלאסי, זה המודל שהטכנולוגיה וההתפתחויות שוללים, זה מה שהעתיד כנראה לא יסבול, ואילו אנחנו כבר שעתיים, זה מה שאנחנו עושים. הפרדוקס הזה של טכנולוגיה מערערת אולי בולט עוד יותר כשאנחנו מדברים על מעמד הספר שמשחק תפקיד במושגים יודע הספר ועם הספר ובית הספר בסביבה שמאופיינת על ידי שני הג'ינג'ים האלה. הג'ינג'ים ימין, מכמה הרצאות שנתתי בחודשיים האחרונים בדקתי, מוכר הרבה יותר לציבור מאשר הג'ינג'ים משמאל. זה שמימין זה מרק צוקרברג, ואני לא חושב שצריך לספר לאף אחד עליו. זה שמשמאל, יוהנס גוטנברג, שהביא לעולם המערבי את הטכנולוגיה של הספר, ונשאלת השאלה על תרומתו של מי לבית הספר בעוד 10 שנים תהיה יותר גדולה. תרומתו של מי לבית הספר, עם דגש על המילה ספר, תהיה יותר גדולה בעוד 10 שנים. ואני רוצה לטעון שגוטנברג עשה מהפכה גדולה, שמאכלסת את ספרי ההיסטוריה הרבה, במעבר מן הקלף הכתוב בכתב יד, בהרבה מאוד מאמץ, בעלות גדולה, אל הספר המודפס שהפך את הספר לנגיש לכולם. ותרומתו של צוקרברג, אני רוצה לטעון, תהיה כבר הובה הרבה יותר גדולה, כי מארון הספרים הזה, למה הבאת את התמונה הזאת? מישהו מזהה פה? לא את הספרים, אלא את הארון? זה לא, זה ארון של איקאה, שעד לפני, זה ארון של איקאה שעד לפני שנתיים היה מוצר רב המחר ברשת הרהיטים הזאת, הוא נקרא מודל של בובי, הם הפסיקו לייצר אותו. והסיבה שהם הפסיקו לייצר אותו זה שספרים הם כבר לא כל כך פופולריים והם משמשים לתפקידים אחרים, לא לקריאה. והתמונות האלה הן עצובות, הן קוראות לב, אבל הן עובדה. הן המצב. אז כשאנחנו מדברים על בית הספר ועל עם הספר ועל לדעת ספר, אנחנו רוצים לשאול את עצמנו מה, אנה פנה הספר. האם זה סיוט או זיכרון או געגוע מתוק, או שהוא בכלל ספר זאת צורתו. אני מאוד אוהב את התמונה הזאת, כי היא מבוא, היא מבוא לטענה הראשונה שלי, ואמרתי, נטען שתי טענות, זו הראשונה. מה אתם רואים פה? אז אתה רואה זקנות מתקדמות, מישהו אחר רואה דור העתיד, הרבה פעמים כששואלים את השאלה, אז אומרים, אנחנו רואים פה ארבע נשים עם מחשב אישי אחד, כן? אני רוצה לטעון שזה בדיוק מה שלא רואים פה. מה שאנחנו רואים פה זה מכשיר שנהוג לקרוא לו מחשב אישי, והוא, סליחה על החזרה לאנגלית לרגע, neither, הוא לא מחשב והוא לא אישי. התרומה של הטכנולוגיה לבית הספר, לכיתה, לגישור על הפער, הגאפ הזה שעליו דיברת סרה, תתחיל ברגע שנבין שזה לא מחשב אישי. It's not a personal computer. זה מכשיר תקשורת קבוצתי. זה מכשיר שהשימוש העיקרי שלו איננו לחישוב, ואופן השימוש העיקרי בו איננו באופן אישי, אלא באופן קבוצתי. הדברים עלו מהנתונים שסיסיליה הציגה לפני דקה. השימוש הוא שימוש קבוצתי, והוא לצרכים שאינם דווקא חישוביים. וכבר בכותרת שאנחנו נותנים לטכנולוגיה עולה התשובה לאיפה צריך לשלב אותה ואיך צריך לשלב אותה, למה היא טובה ולמה היא פחות טובה ואיך היא תשפיע, כשאנחנו נראה את הספר דועך והולך נעלם אל האופק ובמקומו מגיעה טכנולוגיה חדשה. עכשיו, את הטכנולוגיה אנחנו לא נעצור. היא כבר, לא שהיא תגיע, היא כבר מגיעה. השאלה, מה יקרה כאשר היא תגיע? האם נתייחס אליה מנקודת הראות שלנו, השמרנית ולדעתי הלא נכונה, או הנה כמה זקנות מסתכלות על מחשב אישי, או שנדבר, לא, תראו, מדובר פה על קבוצת אנשים משתפת משהו במכשיר תקשורת בצורה לא אישית. תראו, שאותה תמונה יכולה להיקרא בשתי צורות שונות, ואני חושב שזו מטאפורה לטכנולוגיה בכיתה, טכנולוגיה במשפחה, טכנולוגיה בסביבת הלימודים. אז יש מי שדוחה את הטכנולוגיה. בבואנו לשאול לאן תלך הטכנולוגיה, בואו נראה מה הן העקבות, מי הם המעכבים, מה הם המכשולים, מי הם המתנגדים ולמה. ופה למשל פשקבילים ממגזר אחד, האינטרנט הוא אבי אבות הטומאה ורבים חללים מפיל, לחיבור לאינטרנט הוא תועבה, עם כמו בביתו הרי הוא בכלל מביא תועבה לביתו, על האינטרנט אפשר לומר שכל באב לא ישובון, יש לי אוסף גדול של פשקבילים כאלה, אני מביא את הפוסטר הזה לא כי אני מסכים איתו, אבל גם לא כי אני לא מסכים איתו, אני מביא אותו כי אני חושב שעלינו כולנו לשאול את עצמנו ואת המערכות של החינוך בהן אנחנו עובדים, באיזה אופן שונים הפשקבילים האלה מחוזר המנכ״ל בין נדמה לי 16 חודשים, שבסעיף קטן 613 שלו כתוב מורה לא יתחבר עם תלמידיו, לא יאשר בקשת חברות, באיזה מידה זה שונה מהותית מכל באב לא ישובון או האינטרנט הוא תועבה. הסיפור הוא ש מערכות כולן, גם רבנים בקבוצה החרדית וגם מנכ״לים במיניסטריונים ממשלתיים וגם התיקון של חוזר מנכ״ל שיצא לפני כחודש, כולם יוצאים מתוך נקודת הנחה שאפשר לשלוט על המערכות. זה לא רק שאת ההוראה נעשה על ידי sage on the stage, מרצה מן הבמה אל קהל שבעיקרו הוא פסיבי, אלא שאת כל הטכנולוגיה אנחנו נשלוט בצורה ריכוזית. הסיפור הוא לא, זה לא יקרה פשוט כי מהותה של הטכנולוגיה הוא ביזורית, וגם אם מפמרים ומנכ״לים ומנהלי בתי ספר ומורים ומרצים ודקנים וכיוצא באלה יחליטו להתערב, גם אם יכתבו פשקבילים או יצאו לאור חוזרים שמנסים לעצור את הסביבה ממותגת המנות הזאת שעוקפת את המרכז, בעצם מבטלת את עצם קיומו של המרכז, את הסביבה הזאת אי אפשר יהיה לבטל, ולכן הטכנולוגיה מערערת את התפיסה הבסיסית שלנו של מהו המוסד שעליו מדובר. בית הספר הוא בעייתי לא רק בגלל הספר, אלא גם בגלל התפיסה של מהו הבית, איפה המסד שלו, מי תכנן אותו, מי יוציא לו רישיון וכיוצא באלה. ולכן, גם מכירים את הכותרות, למרות האיסור, מורים רבים הם חברים של תלמידיהם בפייסבוק, וחוזר מנכ״ל צריך היה לעדכון עם התנצלות שהשורה התחתונה שלו היא אמנם על פי הוראות המשרד נאסר על מורים, אבל לא בעצם התכווננו, זה היה בשין קופרי, שאנחנו בעצם חושבים אחרת, זה משהו שהולך להיות מתוקן. אז אנחנו, ברור לנו שמשתנים דברים, הספר משתנה והטכנולוגיה משתנה, ומידת היכולת לרכז נעלמת, ממש נעלמת. ואז צריך לעשות דברים אחרת, וכמו שכבר הסגרתי, אני מציע שנחשוב על לעשות דברים אחרת בשני אופנים. אופן אחד שהכותרת שלו היא שיתוף, ואופן שני שהכותרת שלו היא משחק. אני רוצה להציע שגם את כל ההצעות שלי וגם את כל ההצעות של אנשים אחרים נקבל בזהירות. כי אני רוצה להציע שאנחנו לא בהכרח מבינים את הטכנולוגיה לאשורה. אני עכשיו מדבר לא על אחרים, אלא על עצמי. אנחנו לא בהכרח מבינים את הטכנולוגיה לאשורה. אנחנו לא ממש ירדנו לעומקה עד כדי שנוכל להחליט החלטות מדיניות לטווח ארוך. לא שאנחנו פטורים מלקבל החלטות כאלה, אבל לא ברור שיש לנו היכולת לעשות את זה. הדוגמה שאני תמיד מזכיר היא הקריקטורה הקנונית הזאת, שהיא קריקטורה בת 20 ששידרה את הסיסמה הזאת, שבאינטרנט אף אחד לא יודע שאתה כלב. יש חוקרת אינטרנט או אנליסטית מאוד מפורסמת בשם מרי מיקר, שהדוחות החצי שנתיים שלה על מצב האינטרנט הם לחם חוקם של כל מי שעוקב אחרי האינטרנט. היא הוציאה ממש השבוע עוד פעם את הדוח העדכני של מרי מיקר אמצע 2013, והדוח שלה מתחיל עם הקריקטורה הזאת, והיא אומרת, מה שגם אני אומר כבר כמה זמן, תראו כמה הקריקטורה הזאת משעשעת, בעיקר בגלל האופן והמידה שבה היא מוטעית. זה בדיוק לקח, זה בדיוק ההפך, זה לא שאף אחד לא יודע שאתה כלב, אלא אם הקשבתם להרצאה של אריק, ואם הקשבתם לדיון על הכלים האחרים שמאפשרים למעקב, זה לא שאף אחד לא יודע שאתה כלב, יודעים בדיוק שאתה כלב, ובדיוק איפה כל קרצייה, ומי אימן אותך, ומה הפדיגרי שלך, והנתונים קיימים. כדי להבין את הטכנולוגיה צריך לא לטעות ולקבל את הסטריאוטיפים הלא נכונים. אז אולי כן, צריך כלבים יותר צעירים וטכנולוגיה יותר צעירה, ולא לא מסך בומבילה, אלא לפטופ ולא מחשבים זקנים אלא גורי כלבים, ובמקום להגיד באינטרנט אף אחד לא יודע שאתה כלב, להבין שבאינטרנט יודעים 350 איש בדיוק כל דבר שעשית כי הם חברים שלך בפייסבוק, ופה בישראל אנחנו שוברי שיאים בתחום הזה. אם בעולם המספר הממוצע של חברים בפייסבוק למשתמש ממוצע הוא סדר גודל של 150, כלומר מספר דנבר, בארץ הוא כפליים, הוא סדר גודל של 300, אז זו סביבה מאוד חברתית שממנה שום חוזר מנכ״ל לא יעקור, לא רק לא יעקור את הילד, הוא גם לא יעקור את המורה. ואז אם זו הסביבה שבה נמצאים, צריך לשאול את עצמנו אם אנחנו מבינים אותה. לא הבנו אותה כאן, זו הצעה חדשה להבין אותה, ואני רוצה להציע שיש הצעה עוד יותר טובה להבנה שלה. זו סביבה שבה, עם אותה תמה, עם ממש אותה תמה של ותיק וחדש, והחדש על הרצפה, והטכנולוגיה, מספרים סיפור אחר, מספרים בכלל את הסיפור של העסק או הביזנס מודל כמכתיב את זה. אז בואו נחזור למודל. זהו, מה זה? זה כיתה. אנחנו מכירים את זה, מה זאת אומרת? זה ככה, הכיתות שלנו, ככה הם רק 1,000 שנה. והסיפור, כמו שאנחנו צריכים כבר להזיל דמעה, היא העובדה שאין שום מוסד אחר שנכיר אותו היום אילו הכרנו אותו רק לפני 1,000 שנה בצורתו אז. שבית החולים והתחבורה והצבא והחקלאות וכל מוסד או ארגון או צורת פעילות אנושית שמוכרת לנו כבר לא נראית כמו שהיא נראתה לפני 1,000 שנה, אבל בתמונות שהן מימי הביניים המוקדמים אנחנו רואים את הכיתה כמו שהיא היום. על הספר ועל השרשראות הקושרות אותו ויתרנו, אנחנו עוברים לאיזשהו פורמט אחר, על הכיתה לא בהכרח ויתרנו. ונשאלת השאלה, אם גם אחרים כמוני זוכרים את התמונה הזאת די בנוסטלגיה, יש לי מורים שלמדתי אצלם כך, שאני מתגעגע אליהם. אבל השאלה אם אני רוצה גם להשיט את המערכת הזאת על הילדים שלי, האם זו שיטה או שזו הבעיה, אם תסכימו איתי, שהכיתות הצפופות עם מספרים גדולים של ילדים, אני עמדתי בראש בית ספר למוסמכים, זאת אומרת בית ספר לתלמידי תואר שני ושלישי, שהיו בו 500 סטודנטים, וראיתי איך כל שנה מספר האנשים בכיתה הלך ותפח. וזה היה לי ברור שככל שהכיתה תופחת, איכות הלמידה של כל תלמיד, פה אני מדבר לא על תלמידים בני 14, אני מדבר על תלמידים בני 34, איכות השירות, איכות החינוך, איכות הלמידה שמקבלים התלמידים, מתכווצת ככל שהכיתה גדלה, בין השאר בגלל שהבעיה היא ממש הבעיה הזאת. ואל לנו להקל בראש. זה, ככה זה נראה. ככל שהכיתה גדולה יותר, זה נראה כך יותר. אפילו פה באולם הזה יש כמה שתפסו חרוב צהריים. אז אנחנו צריכים לשאול את עצמנו איזה תפקיד משחק את ה, או יכולה לשחק האלקטרוניקה בסביבה הזאת. אני רוצה להחזיר את כולם למאמר שהוא כבר עוד מעט בן 30, שכתב אלי נועם, שנקרא Electronics and the Dim Future of Education, אלקטרוניקה ועתידה המאורפל, עתיד המאורפל של החינוך, שבו כבר לפני 30 שנה, עוד בטרם היות הווב, ודאי בטרם היות פייסבוק, הוא אמר, אורו חברים, זה הולך להשתנות בצורה דרסטית. הולך להשתנות דרסטית בגלל הכיתה ההפוכה שמדברים עליה הרבה, בגלל המוקס שמככבים, ה-massive online open courses שמאיימים על אוניברסיטאות, בגלל החאן אקדמי, ובגלל דברים שאת חלקם כבר הזכירו היום, למשל התפיסה הזאת של פרנסקי, שהתמעטות מי שרואים בטכנולוגיה הזאת משהו זר אליה היגרו מתרבות אחרת, המהגרים הדיגיטליים שתופסים, שתפיסתם היא פסיבית ורצינית וסדורה ומתמשכת ומפוקסת ותעשייתית, והם מדברים על חינוך. את הרשימה הזאת כולה, למעט הפריט האחרון, הקריא פה אבי ורשבסקי כשהוא סיכם את המטרות של מיינדסט. זה היה בדיוק הטבלה הזאת. לעומתם, לעומת המהגרים הדיגיטליים, אומר פרנסקי, וזה שנוי במחלוקת, אפשר לדון על זה, לעומתם צומח דור חדש, זה שנמצא מעבר לגאפ שעליו דיבר שרה, אנשים, ילדים, אבל גם מבוגרים, שתפיסתם היא אקטיבית, ציפיותיהן הן שיהיה כיף, הם רוצים גישה אקראית ונשלטת על ידם לכל תוכן, הם רוצים מיידיות, הם רוצים אפשרות לעשות יותר מדבר אחד בו זמנית, הם מעוניינים ברשתיות, והם לא מתייחסים למערכות חינוך פורמליות, אלא הם מתייחסים לחיים. ובדיוק הפער הזה בין השורה התחתונה בצד שמאל לשורה התחתונה בצד ימין, הפער בין חינוך לבין חיים, זה הפער בין הכיתה לבין מה שנמצא מחוץ לכיתה. יש דברים שהזמן פה לא יתיר להעמיק בהם, אני רק אגיד שבין השאר הטכנולוגיה לא ירדה לעולם במקשה או צורה אחת, יש הבחנה בין טכנולוגיה שצורכים אותה בהסבה לפנים וזו שצורכים אותה בהסבה לאחור, טכנולוגיה כמו המסך הענק הזה ורמקולים גדולים וכיסאות נוחים והזנה שמגיעה אל קהל שברובו פסיבי, לבין טכנולוגיה שמהותה היא רכינה לפנים, הסמארטפון והטאבלט והכלים האחרים, תחשבו על גוגל גלאסס שבוע הבא ואולי על טכנולוגיה שהיא ממש מוטמעת בגוף בשבוע שאחרי כן, טכנולוגיה אליה אנחנו נמשכים באופן יותר דרסטי. הכניסה של טכנולוגיות, בין אם הן כאלה ובין אם הן כאלה, מגדירות סביבה אחרת, סביבה למשל שבה כבר לא מדברים על מסך אחד, על שני מסכים. אנחנו חושבים על מה שעוד מעט אציג ואקרא לו פדגוגיה לודנית, כשאנחנו חושבים על האוסף של הכללים והתורות של איך ללמד בסביבה החדשה את הדור החדש, אנחנו בין השאר צריכים לא לחשוב על מסך אחד, שעליו שמענו הרבה היום, אלא לחשוב על זה שההרגלים הם כבר של יותר מאשר מסך אחד, של לצפות בטלוויזיה ולהיות עם החברים בפייסבוק בו זמנית, של לעקוב אחרי תהליכים פוליטיים ולקרוא את מה שקורה בטוויטר, של להיות בכיתה ולשמוע את ההרצאה, אבל גם להיות מעורבים בבק צ'אנל, בערוץ אחורי שבו אם מערכת החינוך היא נכונה, אם היא חושבת, אם היא מעמיקה, היא מעודדת את התלמידים לעשות שימוש במסך השני ולא מחרימה להם את המכשירים או סרט עליהם. זה נכון, אצלי בשכונה יש שני בתי ספר, בית ספר אחד כשהילד מגיע עם סמארטפון לכיתה מחרימים לו אותו, בית ספר השני מחלקים טאבלטים לכל התלמידים ומבקשים מהם להשתמש בטאבלטים תוך כדי שיעור. זהו מסר כפול שמעיד על מין פיצול אישיות או סכיזופרניה של המערכת שעדיין לא הבינה בחלקה הלא קטן לאן הדברים האלה יכולים להביל. היא לא מבינה בגלל שיש עדיין הרבה התנגדויות. אני אסיר תודה לקריקטוריסט, אם מישהו יודע מי הוא שיגיד לי, כי אני רוצה לתת לו קרדיט. לקריקטוריסט שצייר קריקטורה על השער של שבעה ימים, המוסף של ידיעות אחרונות. קריקטורה בצבעי התקופה הכחולה של פיקאסו, ודפרסיבית אפילו יותר ממנו. קריקטורה ש... אז תראו, תראו את הרימה של הטכנולוגיה כולה מכוונת באופן ברור כדי לפגוע בילד שהוא היחיד שזוכה ל... אז אמרתי לו שלא יהיו תמונות של ילדים, אז הנה יש ילד אחד. כולה מכוונת כדי לפגוע בילד, וזו עמדה שרואים אותה הרבה, שמתייחסים לטכנולוגיה כמשהו שעומד על קרע אחד, חורק, ומגויס כולו, הטכנולוגיה, כדי להזיק לילד, ואני רוצה להציע שאנחנו צריכים לחשוב אחרת. לא על טכנולוגיה מאיימת, אמנם טכנולוגיה מערערת, אבל א', הרבה ממה שהיא מערערת, טוב שיערערו עליו. וב', ויותר חשוב, גם אם נבקה את הערעור, אנחנו לא משוחררים מההרהור. אנחנו לא משוחררים מלחשוב על העניינים. הטכנולוגיה ערערה כבר כל כך הרבה מוסדות, היא מערערת את הפוליטיקה, היא מערערת את מערכת הבריאות, היא מערערת את הביטחון, היא מערערת את התעשייה, והיא מערערת גם את בתי הספר, ואנחנו חייבים לעצמנו תשובה, כאשר הטכנולוגיה גדולה מאיתנו, האם נוכל להמשיך להצדיק את קיומנו בקינות על נזקיה, גם כשהם קיימות, גם כשהם קיימים הנזקים האלה, או שעלינו לעשות משהו אחר? יש לה נזקים, יש המון סיכונים וסכנות לטכנולוגיה, הכל מפגיעה בפרטיות ועד פגיעות אחרות, רשימה ארוכה שיקצר הזמן מלתאר אותו, עודף מידע ואנונימיות ווירוסים ועונה וגניבה וסטייה ומוי טרור והתמכרות וכן הלאה. אני רוצה להדגיש את שתי הסכנות האחרונות ברשותכם. אני רוצה ברשותכם להגיד לגבי האחרות צריך לתת את הדעת, יש להתמודד איתן, אבל ההתמודדות איתן לא יכולה להיות בהוצאת דיבת הטכנולוגיה רעה. ובכל מקרה אחת הסכנות הגדולות ביותר, ואני חושש שפה בישראל אנחנו סובלים מן הסכנה הזאת יותר ממה שאנחנו מודעים לו, הסכנות הגדולות הן שנשאר חס וחלילה מאחור ונתעלם מהזדמנויות, ושתי הדוגמאות הבוערות לסכנה שאנחנו כאן נשאר מאחור ונתעלם מהזדמנויות, הן ההזדמנות של שיתוף, ועוד יותר מזה ההזדמנות של משחק, שמגיעים לחופנו מאוחר מדי, מעט מדי, חלש מדי, וללא שום הצדקה. היה פה כבר הזכור פעמיים היום, על החולשה של ישראלים בטוויטר, רנה דיברה על זה כבר בבוקר והזכירה את זה שוב. אנחנו גם לא מי יודע מה חזקים בבלוגים, אנחנו מאוד חלשים בשיתוף, בהשוואה למערכות שיתוף תוכן אחרות. אני ברשותכם אם ככה, כיוון שאנחנו צריכים לסיים, אני הייתי רוצה לסיים רק בטענה ששיתוף הוא חשוב, משחק כנראה עוד יותר חשוב, והייתי רוצה במסגרת הסיום, אולי רק לסיים שתי האובזרבציות הבאות. אחת, אם אנחנו מדברים על משחק שססיליה הראתה שילדים מאוד אוהבים אותו, שבריין סיפר סיפור לדעתי מדהים על הניצול שלו בבתי ספר אמריקאים, אנחנו צריכים לשאול את עצמנו מנקודת ראות פדגוגית, האם הבנו איך להשתמש במשחק, איך לרתום את המשחק, ובעיקר את המשחק הממוחשב, זה שמאפשר לעשות גם במרחק, זה שיש לו גם סקיילביליטי, כלומר אפשרות לשימוש חוזר, זה שהוא נמצא בסביבה בה נמצאים הילדים, בסמארטפונים ובטאבלטים שלהם, האם הבנו את הפדגוגיה הלודנית? ולהקשר הזה אני רוצה לרתום את התצפית, את התובנה של ג'ונסון, שאומר תראו, קחו את כל ההיסטוריה של המשחקים ששיחקו בהם אבותינו. כל המשחקים המוכרים לנו, מקלאס ועד שחמט, מתופסת ועד מחניים, כל המשחקים המוכרים לנו, ותשאלו את עצמכם, נשאל את עצמנו מה ההבדל בינם לבין מה שאפשר לעשות במחשב. למה מיינקראפט כל כך הרבה יותר מוצלח כדבריה של ססיליה? מה יש דווקא בטכנולוגיה החדשה שמובא אל העולם של משחק? הצעה של ג'ונסון, משהו שאפשר לבלות עליו שעות של דיון, אבל הצעה של ג'ונסון היא, תראו את המשחקים הממוחשבים ואת האופן שבו הם מתנהלים בלי שהשחקנים יודעים מהם כללי המשחק מראש. ואת המשחקים הממוחשבים הם סביבה, המשחקים הממוחשבים הם סביבה שלא כמו במחניים או תופסת, ברידג' או כדורסל, הם סביבה שבה עיקר העניין הוא ברור החוקים עוד לפני שידענו מים. להפך, כשבררתם את החוקים, גם במיינקראפט, הם נהיים פחות מעניינים. ולכן אלה משחקים שתורמים מנקודת ראות של התפיסה הפדגוגית, הלודנית, הם תורמים למה שקוראים אצלנו למידת חקר. אני הייתי רוצה להציע שנחשוב על למידת חקר בתור יעד. אני חושב שהיו פה רמזים לרעיון של inquiry-based learning, של למידת חקר, כמטרה שאליה רוצים לשאוף לאורך היום על ידי מספר דוברים. אני רוצה להגיד שמשחק ממוחשב הוא זה מה שמאפשר לעשות את זה. ואני רוצה להציע שהנקודה השנייה של חשיבה פדגוגית בסביבה טכנולוגית היא העובדה שבניגוד להרבה משחקים, אנחנו חיים בעולם שנעשה יותר ויותר צפוף, יותר ויותר מחובר, יותר ויותר מקושר, גם הכישורים, גם העמדות, גם ההתנהגויות וגם התכונות שהיינו רוצים לפתח אצל תלמידינו הם יותר ויותר בעולם חברתי, ולכן עלינו להסתכל על הטכנולוגיות, חזרה לזקנות המשתמשות ביחד במכשיר תקשורת קבוצתי, לכן התהליך, גם השימוש לטכנולוגיה צריך להיות תהליך יותר קבוצתי. בכל מקום שבו מלמדים ולא מעודדים את המלמדים להשתתף, איכשהו נעלם פה את ההשטג שדובר עליו בבוקר באופן נחרץ, הוא קצת נעלם, אולי כי אנחנו לא מכירים זה, כי אנחנו פוחדים מזה, כי אנחנו לא הרגלנו את עצמנו לזה. אני מציע שנתייחס גם לאלמנט השיתופי, הקולבורטיבי, הקבוצתי, ואני מודה לכם על ההאזנה.
We have a few minutes for questions to any of the panel members, and I'm going to ask Ellie to say some closing words about looking forward, whether we see an evolutionary closing of the gap or whether what's going to happen is a revolution. But we have about 10 minutes for questions, and then I'll give you the final word, Ellie.
Shalom, שאלה קצרה לשזף. איך אתה מסביר את העובדה שאנחנו פי שניים בפייסבוק, זאת אומרת, נספח חברים, לעומת שיתוף כל כך מועט? אני מבין שזה לא זהה, אבל בכל זאת, מה ההבדלים? תודה.
לא יודע, שאלה נהדרת מתאימה למחקר. איך אמר דייוויד ויינברגר? אני לא יודע. יש לי כמה השערות. הרבה יותר מעניין אותי, אבל לעסוק, ברשותך, אני לא אפרט את ההשערות. ובמקום, יש לי רצון, במקום לחקור את השאלה למה זה לא היה, יש לי רצון להאיץ את השינוי. שנשאל את עצמנו באיזה מידה אנחנו יכולים לגשר על הפער, למשל במשחקים. המשחקים הבאמת מוצלחים שחדרו לבתי הספר, אנחנו עשינו פרויקטים בכמה חטיבות ביניים ובתיכונים, אשמח לספר עליהם, עשינו קצת יותר ברמת האוניברסיטה, אבל זה טיפה בים, יחסית למה שכבר יש במוסדות לימוד בעולם. למה אנחנו מפגרים שם? למה אנחנו בפייסבוק מדברים יותר? למה בטוויטר אנחנו מדברים פחות? אנחנו יכולים להיכנס לסמינרים אקדמיים מרתקים, זה מה שזו הפרנסה שלי, בלחקור למה הישראלי אוהב לדבר הרבה ולא אוהב שיקצו. זה הסיפור של הרבה פייסבוק אבל מעט טוויטר. ואפשר לעשות שם ניתוחים פסיכולוגיים, סוציולוגיים, הרבה יותר חשוב שנשאל את עצמנו מה אנחנו עושים כדי לשנות את זה. אפשר להגיד, סוק הרבה בהבדל בין ילדים וילדות, במידת השימוש במשחקים, בנתונים שסיסיליה הציגה, וזה מעניין מבחינה אקדמית, הרבה יותר חשוב שנשאל את עצמנו איך לסגור את הפער הזה. אפשר לדבר על פערים דיגיטליים, להתעסק הרבה מאוד בתיאור שלהם, ואפשר לשאול, אני מציע לרתום את האנרגיות הרבה יותר לאיך סוגרים את הפערים האלה.
האם אנחנו בעצם בשימוש לא נכון מייצרים ילדים עם הפרעות קשב, כפי שה-DSM-5 מגדיר ADHD, או שבעצם הטכנולוגיה מוצאת ביטוי לטבע הילד שרוצה להקיף את כל העולם ללמוד ולדעת.
I have no doubt about that we are producing a lot of AI. I think that not only me, I think a lot of people would agree that the gap that we are talking about, it's producing kids that just come to an educational environment that doesn't speak their language, that say that they're supposed to learn there, but they actually learn through different processes. So their defense mechanisms is just to switch off. And because us adults have to try to categorize them and put them in right boxes, we call them ADHD. I'm not saying there are no kids with ADHD. We all know there are. But the number that we see today should, you know, I think should raise an alarm to us, asking if all the ones we are saying are ADHD are really there, or if that's just a symptom of the gap we're talking about.
I'll speak to the issue of listening skills as well. The most important listening skills are developed in children before they come to school. And we know that when children are in language-rich environments in the home, where a lot of talking, listening, and social interaction happens, human to human, that and when a good, rich vocabulary that relates to the objects of everyday life are part of the discourse, the children come to school with good language skills, good listening skills, and the capacity to build on those skills. But we have all encountered how so much screen media disrupts the relationships in our family lives. We see parents pass their cell phone to their baby while they eat dinner. We see in the car when the child is being transported, instead of talking and listening, there is a DVD player. So in fact, many children get much less exposure to rich language environments in the first 5 years of life. And so I do think we want to understand that listening skill is contextual and situational, and that screen media does shape the way in which we use language in the family life.
אני מורה ממחנכת כמעט 30 שנה במערכת בגילי חטיבת ביניים, ואני חייבת לציין שעם כל הטכנולוגיה שהיא מתקדמת, עם כל הכבוד, אני רואה יום יום את המחיר של הטכנולוגיה בנפש ובחיי הילד. ילדים חסר להם כישורים חברתיים, הם חכמים מאחורי המסך, מקללים אחד את השני, אז הם מפסידים, אז עוד פעם מנסים. כשמגיעים לבית הספר, הם לא יודעים להתמודד עם הקשיים, הם מתוסכלים, הפתרונות הם פתרונות, הם מוצאים כאן ומיד, הם מיד מצלצלים להורים, לא מתמודדים עם קשיים, לא עושים פעילות ספורטיבית, לא רוצים לצאת לטיולים, לא רוצים להקשיב למדריך, יושבים בהפסקות ורק עם האצבעות הם משחקים, זה הספורט שהם עושים. ואני מדברת על חלק גדול מהתלמידים, ברור שיש יוצאי דופן ויכול להיות שיש אזורים בארץ שזה ממש לא יבוא לידי ביטוי, אני מדברת במרכז הארץ, באחת הערים הגדולות בארץ. ואני רואה את המחיר הכבד שהילדים האלה משלמים בגלל השימוש הרב בסמארטפון. הם אפילו בכיתה, אני כותבת את השיעורים על הלוח, הם אפילו, אחרי שאני יוצאת מהכיתה, אני קולטת שהם לא העתיקו את השיעורים, לוקחים, מצלמים את שיעורי הבית. הם בטח גם לא מכינים אותם. זה מה שהם עושים, ואני רואה את המחיר הכבד שאנחנו כחברה הולכים לשלם על ילדים שלא יודעים לתקשר, לדבר זה עם זה. אני אתן דוגמה, השנה האחרונה שסיימתי לחנך ט', הם היו צריכים להגיע במונית, אמרתי לתלמיד, צלצל לתחנת מוניות, תזמין מונית. אז הוא אומר לי, איך עושים את זה? אני אומרת לו, מה זאת אומרת? אני אמרתי, הנה זאת תחנת המוניות, אני נותנת לו את הספורט, לא יודע, לא יודע לבקש, לא, תגידי לי את. הוא לא יודע להגיד, בבקשה, אני צריך מונית, ילד נבון בכיתה ט'.
טוב, אני חושב שאת מתייחסת כמו כולנו בעצם לבעיית המסגרת ואיך מתמודדים עם מסגרות. והבעיה היא שבאמת אין מסגרת ואנחנו עושים דמיון כאילו שיש מסגרת, שזה נחמד, אבל היא איננה. והיא ככל שיעבור הזמן היא תהיה פחות ופחות. וכל מה שאנחנו חושבים עליו כבונה אותה הולך ויורד. אנחנו כרגע נמצאים באיזשהו שלב ביניים. אם אתם זוכרים, פעם היינו מדברים על שבירת גבולות הכיתה. פעם היינו מדברים על הכנסה של... היינו... פרוג'קטור, זה טכנולוגיה. נופלים הקירות של הכיתה, אפשר לשלוח מייל, אפשר להראות סרטון ביוטיוב בכיתה. כל הכבוד. זה לא מעניין יותר. אנחנו מדברים היום על אינדיבידואליזציה. כשאמזון בא, מה שקורה בעצם, הוא אומר, תראו, כל אדם הוא אדם מיוחד. היה צריך שיהיה מורה לכל ילד. ככה גם היה פעם. ואנחנו לאט לאט מבינים שהילדים הם כל כך שונים זה מזה, שהם צריכים דברים שונים. מערכת של אריק יכולה לתת לנו אינפורמציה על כל ילד. אבל אנחנו לא יכולים. אי אפשר. כמה מורים כבר אנחנו יכולים להביא, כי זה לא יעזור באיזשהו שלב. אז אנחנו צריכים שיטה אחרת. והשיטה האחרת היא שימוש בטכנולוגיה, מה שנורא מפחיד. אבל בסופו של דבר יכול להיות שלא יהיה קורסים, כי אנחנו רוצים ללמוד בדיוק בזמן את מה שאנחנו רוצים. אז המושג הקורס הוא כבר לא כל כך משמעותי. יכול להיות שאנחנו יכולים לקבל מידע מכל המקומות ביחד כדי שהמורים יוכלו להעלות את הרמה. המורה הוא מהנדס למידה, זה מקצוע חדש. אלה שיוכלו לעבור למקצוע הזה יצליחו, אלה שלא, זאת תהיה בעיה, כי בייביסיטרים כבר פחות אכפת. המשולש הזה של מורה, כיתה, תוכן, תלמיד, כן? כלומר, מורה, תלמיד, תוכן, בתוך כיתה, זאת מסגרת שהולכת ומזדעזעת. זה קרה בכל המקצועות עד היום, זה גרם לפיתורים, זה גרם לשינויים, חלק נשארו, חלק עזבו, זה קורה עכשיו לחינוך, מצער, אבל עובדה. יש בזה גם תקווה. והתלמידים יכולים ללמוד להשתמש באפליקציה גט טקסי, ואז הם ישיגו טקסי כמו שצריך, אם ילמדו אותם. אבל הם גם יכולים ללמד את עצמם, זה יהיה בסדר. אבל מעבר לזה, יש שלב היברידי. אנחנו כרגע באיזשהו שלב היברידי, יש על זה מאמרים, זה קשה. יש בזה גרירת רגליים ששזב דיבר עליה. זה באמת בעיה. אבל בסופו של דבר, אהבתי מאוד אינטראקציה שהייתה פה בין מנהל בית ספר ובין המפתחת של מתח. כשהמנהל בית ספר אמר לה, את חייבת להגיע לכיתה ומהר. בעוד שהיא, למה? כי הוא מבין שהיא בעצם לא מבינה מה קורה בכיתה. אבל היא חושבת הפוך, היא חושבת, אתה צריך לצאת מהר כדי לראות מה קורה בחוץ. כי משהו בחוץ קורה אחרת ממה שקורה בפנים. ומה שבריין לימד אותנו, זה שהאחרת שקורה בחוץ כנראה הרבה יותר משמעותי ממה שקורה בפנים. לעת, לטווח הארוך, בינתיים יש כל מיני מסגרות, אבל לטווח הארוך, העסק הזה הולך להשתנות באופן מאוד מאוד קיצוני. שיהיה לכולנו בהצלחה.